Elephant, Derek Gray, Malkin Lane, as the bass bumped off the side of Snake Mountain. Jim on the stage with the hologram girls. Next up, Allison Blair to light the star of a night at the bar at the end of the world that my mind can't erase. There were 10 in the bed and the Thundercats said, roll over, roll over. There were 9 in the bed and the Amazon said, roll over, roll over. So we all rolled over and both fell out. Then they hopped in the jet with the growl and pow. Roll over, roll over, roll over, roll over. Final call came, there were shops all.
Good evening. Welcome to Animates, the show where a group of monstrous mates discuss their favorite animated shows and have some fun along the way, despite my best efforts. I'm Will. This is Yeah. As you may be aware, it's Spoopy Month here on Animates, which means that we're giving you a rundown of the greatest tunes that are creepy, kooky, and all together kooky. Joining me this week, this month, David, the Quinvisible Man.
Where am I?
Over there.
All I can see is some dude saying kiss me, which is really creeping me out.
That's me, sorry.
Okay. Hey, buddy.
The spooky scaleless sailor scout of your nightmares, Jill Breathlessness.
I just realized and that's our, shit.
And our special new mate added to the crew this month is the monstrous of martial arts, the lovely Amyable. Welcome to the crew.
Thank you.
I'm sure you're in for a fright. There's there a reason for me having two screens, which will become apparent.
Can you just do a little bit of looking between the two screens? Like just
why yes.
Sexy one.
Yes, I can.
Sexy two.
One's sexy the one? Evil twin that will never know you which. Know,
I'm Will and this is Yeah.
So hot.
So I'm sure everyone's excited to look at my scraggly beard and whatever other orify they might get a sneak peek up from the ultimate view.
Orify, the plural of orifices?
Yeah, that's the plural of orifices. So it's like it's a multi orifice.
Outstanding.
I'm pretty sure they were the bad guys in season 10 of Stargate, but, you know, that's a totally different thing.
They were. The Ori.
Yeah. I mean, it's just with the silent F. Silent F.
Their champion is a warrior named Orifier. Anyway, moving on. Tonight, of course, we'll be talking about spoopy tunes. A little later on, of course, we'll be opening up the reboot and taking some of your favorite cartoons and turning them into horrific monstrosities that belong on the island of Dr. Moreau. And a little change of pace tonight. Tonight, one of the mates and maybe someone playing along at home has a chance to win a fabulous prize.
Yay! Oh. Enough prizes!
I thought you were going to say one of us is going to die.
That is, in fact,
more
the fabulous. How am I disappointed?
I mean... Now I want multiple cameras for every show we do.
I know, right? It's great.
Well, this is very exciting. Have we all had a nice, I was going to say Halloween month, because that's essentially what it is now, isn't it?
It is.
The entire month of Halloween. Okay. Yeah. I'm not sure which one I love more either. Both. But we can also
I was concerned when she... Oh, wait, I'm hiding the logo. I was concerned when she joined the chat and she's like, I just had a bite. And
yeah, I just had a quick bite. Dripping from her
mouth. So that's not the first thing she said to me. It was also in another one just going, look down, you fucking idiot.
I did not say you fucking idiot. I just called you, you fuck.
Yeah.
So, much close enough.
Ah, oh, dear. So, Will, how do we do this? I'm excited.
Well, look, you know, normally we might futz around for a few minutes and go, guys, who wants to go first? Oh, not me, not you. Like, oh, you go if you want to. None of that rubbish anymore. We're gamifying Animates, people. We are gamifying it. It is a competition now. If you're going to go, you have to win.
Kind this of, is terrifying.
Really.
Yeah, I like this. Let's just go full Squid Game.
Pretty much. Pretty much.
So and if I lose, course... I can just sit out, right?
Yeah. No.
Until you die.
Till the next round, you can. Yeah. and of course,
Kanger, it's never a race unless it's a race.
Yeah. And of course, you know,
unless it's the cruise.
Yeah.
What other game would you play at Halloween than everyone's favorite game?
Spin the bottle.
Wheel of Fortune. Thanks to my lovely co-hosts, Morticia and Latricia.
I'm not sure Latricia. Who I'm more worried about because they both have that Billie Eilish, I don't give a fuck about you look about them.
Yeah. Oh, they've eaten everyone else in the room.
You can tell.
Yes, yeah. That's right, Casper. We went all out tonight. And by me, I mean Will.
Yeah.
Now, of course, as you may remember from the annals of your memory, in Wheel of Fortune, a puzzle board appears where the letters of a person, place, thing, or other category will appear. The letters will appear and... the first person to guess what the puzzle is will be able to go first and present their favorite show.
Okay. I don't know about... Is everyone else ready?
Here is our puzzle board.
Let's do it.
Okay.
Let's go.
Shit, that's long.
Here is our first puzzle.
Do I get to buy a vowel?
You have to wait for your turn, goddammit.
It's a title. Oh.
It's a title. Good. Mm. Okay.
Everyone ready?
Of some kind of horror media. Is that correct?
Yes. Everything relates to a scary or spooky cartoon.
Okay.
Okay. The letters will start appearing when the music starts.
Okay. So there is no actual Wheel of Fortune. It is literally just Wheel.
It's the Wheel of Fortune. Wheel of Fortune.
So we just like scream out?
Yeah. As soon as you can guess what it is. Yeah. Okay. Or you can have buzzer noises if you want, but I don't think we need to worry about it. And of course, all decisions are made by he's the adjudicator.
Unbiased.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Siri is the adjudicator. Thank you.
Cool. Thanks, Siri.
My computer just Siri. Okay, title. Here we go.
It's like make buzzer noises. Dance, monkey, dance.
It's a title. Here we go.
Okay. It starts with V. Should be V something.
Yeah.
The and it's Christmas. See, it's totally
the something universe. No.
Porn. Something porn. The
last unicorn.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, go Jill.
Yeah.
Is that horror?
Yeah, well, you haven't seen it. It's fucking horrific.
It's scary.
Oh, I still haven't seen it.
It's properly scary. It's weird.
That's Jill's celebration. Woo.
I wasn't expecting this much music, man.
It's a lot. It's a full production, baby. So, Jill, what's up?
Yeah. Right. Okay. So,
I think we can turn off for a bit, right?
Oh, okay. Which one's there? Is that me?
No.
That's me.
Whoops.
Okay. Right. So, Jill.
Oh, and we'll be we'll be back after Jill's presentation, of course, for round two. And later, someone has the chance to win the grand prize on Wheel of Fortune.
Okay. Ooh. So we will share Jill's.
Yes. Thank you. Tonight, I'm talking about Blood the Last Vampire, an anime classic from 2000. The Last Vampire was produced by Production IG, which is like my favorite anime studio in Japan, and SPE Visual Works, and directed by Hiroyuki Kitakubo. Its main protagonist is a girl named Saya, who hunts human-sized bat-like creatures called Chiropterans that can shapeshift into human beings. So, like, basically a werebat.
That's fucking tough.
Yeah, it's sick.
Like, it's sick.
Yeah. So, Saya hunts Chiropterans using a katana. Yeah. It is implied that she is the last remaining vampire and called the only remaining original. Saya has no weakness to sunlight, although it is unknown if she has any of the other vulnerabilities often attributed to vampires. Saya displays superhuman senses and strength, as well as cunning, resourcefulness, and skill. Her age is unknown, but a picture of her with 9 other people is shown in the film with the date 1892 and the word vampire attached to it. Though she holds most humans in contempt, she seems to have some sort of respect for David. Oh, isn't that nice, David?
That's nice of her. Appreciate
Who's
it.
David?
But this is David. Sorry, not what I was Quinny. Expecting. It's this David.
Not what I was. Kind of looks like him.
If Quinny had hair, this is him.
Yeah, he's a foot and a half taller and 20 kilos lighter. Yeah.
So and David is a man.
He has the same dead eyes, though.
Shut up. David is a man working for the US government organization called the Red Shield. He relays missions to Saya and helps her at various points in the film. This is a Chiropteran from the Greek for hand wings. They are blood-feeding bat-like creatures comparable to humans in intelligence. They disguise themselves as people and can gradually transform, becoming large, monstrous, and long-limbed. In this form, a further transformation produces leathery wings that allow the creature to glide but not fly. Chiroptera live by feeding on human blood. They possess extraordinary speed and strength. They heal almost instantly from any non-lethal wound. But because of this, the only way to easily kill them is to cause them to lose a sufficiently large amount of blood from one attack. My goodness. Yeah, so you got to try really hard. Now, the plot. The story is set in 1966. Saya's next mission begins at the American Yokota Air Base, which is active in the build-up to the Vietnam War. At least one Chiropteran has managed to infiltrate the airbase, and it is only a matter of time before they feed again, go into hibernation, and become untraceable. Saya is to pose as a schoolgirl, infiltrate the high school adjacent to the base, and then track and kill the Chiropterans. So, Production IG's president wanted to produce a new project that was an original concept rather than being an adaptation of an existing anime or manga series. So, the submissions became the basis for the upcoming film, a girl in a sailor suit wielding a samurai sword. Because what else is as cool as that, right?
That's all you need.
Yeah. When you talk about Nothing. Japan, you think of sailor suit girls and swords.
Yeah.
So Yokota Air Base was suggested for the film setting and because it's referred to as the state of California within Japan. So that was the vibe they were going for. The film uses completely digital animation. So rather than following the tradition of using animation cells, the entire film was inked, colored, and then animated with computers. It also uses primarily low light settings, with much of the film featuring large amounts of gray and brown, as you can see here. In directing the film, Kitakubo notes that his having read Dracula and watching the American television series Buffy the Vampire Slayer may have had some influence on the film, as the rest of his life experiences have. So Production IG broke new ground in Blood the Last Vampire by being the first company to film an entire anime series almost entirely in English with Japanese subtitles, feeling that it would help with the film reach foreign markets more easily. The resulting film is very short for a theatrical work, spanning only 45 minutes. Kitakubo stated in a 2001 interview that he had the remaining story of Saya's past, present, and future in his own mind, but that it was up to the others involved in its making as to whether there would be a sequel. So, Production IG had Bekio Tamaoki write a manga sequel to complete the story. It brings Saya to the year 2002. So from the original film was 1966, and now she's in 2002. With a new generation of handlers and continuing her quest to destroy Chiropterans. In the manga, David has retired and Saya has a new handler who makes it abundantly clear that he has no respect for her. He sends her to high school under the name of Saya Otonashi. There she learns that Chiropterans coexisted with humans until humans began experimenting on them in the 19th century to try to gain immortality. Classic humans.
Bloody human.
That brings us to 2005, where Sony and Production IG announced the creation of Blood Plus, a 50-episode anime television series, and in my personal opinion, the best iteration of this franchise. It is held to be an... Oh, mate, let me tell you. It is held to be an alternate universe telling of Blood the Last Vampire. It only has minor connections and similarities to the film and many differences. The anime became its own franchise with two light novel series, adaptions, three manga adaptions, and two video games.
Ooh.
Wow. Yes. The series is initially set in September 2005 in Okinawa, near the US Kadena Air Base. Under the care of her adoptive family, the protagonist Saya Otonashi, so the name that she was given in the manga, had been living the life of an anemic amnesiac, but otherwise ordinary schoolgirl. Classic. Where was I up to? However, her happy life is shattered when she is attacked by a Chiropteran. Saya learns that she is the only one who can defeat them as her blood causes their bodies to crystallize and shatter, which is like a cooler way to die rather than just, you know, significant blood loss. Armed with her special katana, Saya embarks on a journey with her family, friends, allies, and her chevalier Haji, which is the dude in the background there, to rid the world of the Chiropteran threat and recover her identity. The course of the journey reveals the background history of the Chiropterans and Saya's mysterious past, which extends into the mid-19th century. This series, I'm just going off what I've written, is phenomenal. Like, I cried so much in this show. Like, the way that they did her history and, like, a connection to, like, a new family and stuff was just, like, insanely good. And the chevalier concept, like, why do we have to have, like, this guy? I don't know. But it just... kind of works because he's a little bit like a butler, but he's also like a super duper love interest, and he's just got like this devotion to her and like keeping her alive. But there's this whole other backstory on how the chevaliers are created from Saya, and yeah, I highly recommend seeking out that anime series because
do you know where it's so good. Do you know where it's available to watch? Or is it like one of those, I'm like you have to vaguely track down somewhere?
I am not sure where you could find it. Perhaps an anime streaming service will have it or the internet, yeah. Because that's where I watched it in 2005. Yeah. But holy shit, it is sounds so amazing. Good. Sounds so good.
I remember very clearly when the film came out, it was a big deal. Like, everybody was talking about it.
Yeah.
And then people went and watched it and went, that's very pretty, but it's only 45 minutes. Where's the rest of it?
Yeah, exactly. And the sad thing is about the film that it doesn't get to go into a lot of backstory, but that's where you get all the juicy stuff in Blood Plus is they're like, okay, let's take that concept and let's run with it and let's explore all that other stuff. So it's not necessarily the same universe as the film, but it does kind of have that kind of feel. And yeah, it's very cool.
So the ongoing series is called Blood Plus.
Yes.
Right.
PLUS, but the plus sign.
Yeah, I remember not knowing that. I remember seeing that, you know, out on the
Sorry, Quinny, you're frozen. You remember seeing it where?
On the piratical waves of the internet.
Ah, yes, yes, yes.
And not knowing that it was linked to the same thing.
Ah, yes.
Okay,
yes.
That's very cool.
Yes. So then, in 2011, Clamp, which is a very famous manga studio in Japan, if you're
old, have heard of it. Code Geass, right?
Code Geass, Tsubasa, Cardcaptor Sakura, a heap of stuff. Very, very famous.
Beautiful, popular. Unique style that they have, right? Like, it's very idiosyncratic. Like,
yeah, I mean, look at this picture and you're like, oh, yeah, that's Clamp. Yeah. So Clamp and Production IG announced their collaboration of a 12-episode anime television series called Blood Sea, and this is a spin-off series. It's also set in a different universe from the film and the previous anime, and only shares the main character having a katana as her main weapon and the basic premise of her defeating monsters with that sword. I gotta say, it's not worth watching, which is unfortunate. As Clamp kind of progressed through the decades, I kind of feel like Code Geass was probably their last great anime story. Everything after that just kind of felt a little bit contrived, especially stuff like Exholic and Blood Sea. It all became, oh, hey, we're known for like our stylized anime people that are all like bizarrely long-limbed and come from the school of Rob Liefeld in terms of proportions.
It's a bit like Aeon Flux or something like that. Like,
yeah, it's kind of weird. Yeah. And it was all like substance over content. Wait, style over substance. Yeah, it just like super highly stylized, like you can see in this image here, and just like not very deep in their storytelling. So if you're going to seek out anything from Blood, don't watch Blood Sea. Just avoid that. It also had a movie. And I forgot to put it in the slideshow because I only worked on this today, but there is a live-action version of Blood, the Last Vampire.
What?
I think I watched it. Came out quite a while ago, but it's not bad.
Oh.
Yeah, cool. Really cool. I had
I'm
no
surprised
idea
it's not bad.
Yeah.
Well, I'm convinced. Honest,
it's a pretty fucking rare thing that a anime translation. Yeah.
But maybe Quinny could
I'm literally pulling it up right now.
Give us a trailer. Sorry, I didn't give you any links. I was hit and miss on if I was gonna show up tonight. So a little bit last minute for me, I apologize.
Here we go. So let's just go back a bit and then.
Since the dawn of time.
You getting the audio?
A war has raged. Between those who fight for the dark.
Maybe someone else should share the video.
How to get your wish. Face the leader of the pack.
She is the last of her kind.
Oh, I remember watching
Half Blood with one purpose.
What are you doing?
It's not your war. Go home. I can take care of myself.
To seek out a demon and end what no one else can.
Oh.
I live for one purpose. And one purpose only. To kill blood suffers.
From a producer of Hero and Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Now I'm making tears, blood will be shed.
Based on the cult hit series Blood, the Last Vampire. Coming soon.
Okay.
Yeah.
I tell you, I was convinced until I didn't like the live action trailer, but I'll watch the anime.
Yes, do watch the anime. The anime is very good.
Yeah, I kind of... Ah, shut up. It's still going in the background. yeah, I have a vague feeling I may have watched that because I do remember loving the anime and then going, oh, there's a live-action version because I think I've said it before, but I had a real jam for a while of trying to find live-action versions of anime. it was my thing. Turns out it's a dumb thing.
Yeah, we had a hill to die on, but okay.
Yeah, anything but watch an anime, right, Quinny?
Yeah, absolutely. Fuck your anime.
Honestly, white people, I don't want to be English.
He doesn't care about sub or dub. He cares about live action, baby.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, I went seeking out all sorts of weird, random fucking live action stuff, like the live action version of Wicked City, Crying Freeman. Yes, Chest Angela.
Oh, no.
Yes, let me tell you, the live action version of Wicked City is a big fucking mood.
Yeah, I mean, if it wasn't pornographic enough, you had to watch the live action.
Yep, Jesus, yep. There is still the lady, the spider lady with the angry vagina.
What
yep.
about the one with like the motorbike handlebars?
Oh, yeah.
The stripper with the motorbike handlebar on her back.
I can't remember.
Yeah.
It's not good. But as something else, it's not sub or dub, it's definitely sub or dom.
Sub or dom. Yeah.
And yes, Chess Angela Crying Freeman is by far the best live action version of an anime of all time. But anyway, I digress. Will, what are we doing next?
Round two.
Thank you so much. It is time for round two. Hello, Morticia and Latricia. Hope you're doing well. Thanks for coming along this week. Yeah,
I
was struggling for a second. Oh, wait, you muted
well,
my...
Well, you almost forgot the name.
You muted, yeah. You need to put yeah in so the music comes back.
Oh, hang on. I have to have both of you, otherwise the audio doesn't work. There you go.
I am yeah, and I am hosting this round of Wheel of Fortune, or as I like to call it, Yeah of Misery.
Oh.
Oh. This round...
Ooh.
Oh, shit.
Ooh.
It's a star and roll.
Oh.
Okay.
Jill, you won the last round, so do not play this round.
All right, I shut up.
Let Jill do her whole thing again. It'll be great.
I mean, you can, but yeah. It's,
or unless you want, if you want to dominate who dies next. Yeah.
Oh.
Okay. Star okay. roll. Here we go.
It ends with an N, I know that.
I like how you start guessing straight away, Quinny.
Yeah, totally. Because there's always that possibility that,
Brad
like...
Brad Pitt.
Joint Pastel
is Spoon. Capitan. Oh, it is Spoon.
Keith David as someone.
Spawn. Keith David as Spawn.
You got it.
Yay! Woo! Oh shit, that means I have to do my thing, doesn't it?
Yeah, yep. You next.
That's right, well it done. Is Keith David as Spawn as the delightful demon lady swings her hammer in the background.
Oh, is that
alarming? Yeah. Now, coming up later, we will take a sniff of the reboot and one of our mates and possibly a home viewer has the chance to win a fabulous prize. But right now, though, it's time for Quinny to talk about some show.
His internet works.
That I forget.
Yeah, herein lies my big problem. Okay, I'm just Goodbye. Making sure that this is working.
You can get rid of yeah now.
Okay, cool. I'm just getting rid of all of the things, making sure that... Okay, so many of you probably had an idea as to what I was going to be talking about. I can't tell which one's bleh. Show me which one's bleh.
This one is bleh.
Okay, good. That one's gone then. Yeah. Okay. Many of you probably had a bit of an idea as to what I was going to talk about because I am a basic bitch and most of you know the things that I'm interested in. And I'm okay with that. So here is what I was going to talk about. Ta-da! There.
Buffering. Yay!
I was, of course, going to be talking about...
Oh, my God, I'm so excited for you to talk about the real Ghostbusters. It's so exciting. I can't believe you're finally going to talk about it on the show.
Yeah, yeah. Because I've certainly never talked about it at length on this show before.
No.
I'm so excited.
I mean,
Spoopy, you're excited. Feel these nipples.
My word.
So I was going to talk about this, and I was very excited to talk about this because there's a new Ghostbusters movie coming out soon.
Yeah,
and
perfect time.
I know. It would have been amazing. I know. But then I realized that somebody had already done it this fucking week.
So there's a
wonderful website called Toy Galaxy.
After riding the wave of popularity following two feature
cheater.
Films, it turns out you
I know,
can't
right?
have too
I'm
much
not
of a good thing.
Play the whole thing.
Question is, once you've realized it, do you?
Ghost.
Spoilers.
Fucking so many ghosts.
In the middle of the night.
Okay. If you want to see the presentation that I would have given, probably actually done better than the presentation I would have given.
After riding the wave of popularity following.
You can go and have a look at the Toy Galaxy thing. It is more detailed than perhaps anyone needs about the real Ghostbusters. And it covers everything, including like the writing team. The person who is probably most responsible for it is J. Michael Straczynski, as in the guy who made Babylon 5. There's a lot of great history. There's a wonderful video. So we're not, and that fucked that idea.
Oh no, I'm so excited.
So I decided maybe I can do one of the other Ghostbusters, the Filmation Ghostbusters.
What the heck am I looking at?
Uh-huh.
Isn't that like Smokey the fucking bear?
No, it's a monkey. It's a monkey.
Oh, what?
Okay. So I realized I was like, yeah, I could do the other Ghostbusters. So released less than a week before the real Ghostbusters.
Okay, wait. This looks like Ghostbusters, but from Wish.
Yeah.
They're in a fucking jalopy. The ghost is like a bad knockoff.
Uh-huh.
Smokey the Bear is somehow there.
Yep.
Ghost busted.
So one thing that they didn't mention in the actual Toy Galaxy thing is that, yes, it is Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
Chitty Shitty Bang Bang.
That they mention it, and once again, going back and watch that video, they'll tell you why this even exists. But basically, there was another film that was made in 1975 and a TV series called Ghostbusters that the production company said, fuck, we really like that name. They filmed half of the movie with it being called Ghost Smashers. And then went, okay, no, we really need the title Ghostbusters because we've now filmed some of the big crowd scenes with all of the crowd chanting Ghostbusters. So, there's some really great stuff about that. But the other company that owned the rights to Ghostbusters sold their animation rights to Filmation and said, hey, there's this TV show. Do you want to make a thing? And they got their cartoon a week ahead of the real Ghostbusters. You can find out all about that. I'm not going to talk about that. There's a heap of stuff about it. There's toys. There's all sorts of shit. It's terrible. So I'm going to talk about a guy that I met a little while ago, quite a few years ago.
This is such a journey.
I know, right? I'm taking you on a journey. So this is at a Supernova many years ago. We had this gentleman as a guest. So he's the creator of Squee, but probably best known to most people is the guy who created Invader Zim. Lovely guy, Mexican-American dude, a lot of fun. And he said to us one night after randomly Hayden Panettiere had run into our room, stolen all of our candy and run out, he's like, do you want to see the most fucked up thing on the internet? And when Jonan Vasquez says, do you want to see the most fucked up? You say, yes, please. Show me the most fucked up thing on the internet. And so he introduced us to this. And this is not something that I'm necessarily recommending you go and watch. But I'm going to show you something that will do your head in. So in some places in the UK, it's called Comet Quest. This is not its real name. Its real name is The Adventures of Mark Twain. Now, I know you're all looking at me going, duh.
How is that horror?
Exactly. So the Adventures of Mark Twain is a feature-length film, claymation, that includes a whole bunch of stories from Mark Twain, and the characters of Huck Finn and Tom Sawyer and Becky Thatcher. So you're like, what the fuck is this? This is not what I'm showing you. So it was made in 1984, 85, a guy called Will Vinton, funny that, and a team of 17 animators in a basement and a 4,000 foot square studio. So Mark Twain at one point said, I came in with Halley's Comet in 1835 and in 1910 it's coming around and I'd like to go out with it. And that's what they based the film on. They went, okay, Mark Twain wanted to die at the same time as Halley's Comet. So they said, let's make an animated film out of it. So here's the trailer. It's all very, you know, clay.
Yeah.
Great Scott, what a contraption.
You are stowaways.
Mark
Twain. Creepy as fuck, let's be honest. Like, it's weird.
I came in with Halley's Comet, and I expect to go out with it.
Anyway. You got a bit of an idea as to what it's like.
Yeah, like the never-ending journey, but shit and educational, probably.
Yeah, exactly. It's certainly got hints of education in it.
A bit like this presentation.
Yeah, hints.
No.
Hang on, it's playing again.
So this is the trailer to something you're not talking about.
Yeah, that's correct. Okay. Hang on. Why are you not... Go out of the thing. Stop it. Go. It won't let me out of the fucking...
If you press escape.
Maybe. Yeah.
There you go.
Okay. So this is not what he showed me. What he showed us was the single most fucked up thing that I've ever seen animated. And because this is our scary Halloween show, I wanted to share it all with you. This is from about 40 minutes into that film.
Okay.
Okay. Prepare yourself. I need to make sure that you can hear it.
Yes.
Okay.
There's audio. Cool.
Right. Oh, for fuck's sake. Four, three. Ah!
Shit, no, dude. Okay.
The penis monster is intimidating. Oh,
hello.
Who are you?
An angel. What's your name?
Satan.
What's the matter?
Nothing. Only it's sure a sorry name for an angel.
Please, come in.
Come on.
Amazing.
I had this happen to me in Chinatown once.
It's a rite of passage.
Yeah. Just in the back of a karaoke bar.
How do you learn to do that? I didn't learn it at all. It comes naturally to me, like other curious things. Are you hungry?
Sure am.
What kind of fruit do you like the most?
Oranges!
Apples?
Grapes.
Ooh.
Grapes.
Yes.
Where'd he go?
What happened to him?
Here. Oh, boy.
Can we help?
You may make some people.
I'll make the king and queen.
I'm gonna make a soldier.
I have a bad feeling about this.
Look at that little village.
There. Here's a buddy.
Now we'll give him life.
Moving.
Looks like my pap on Saturday night.
Wow. Look, they're moving.
There's like big old people.
Wow.
Rob, that is now a trademark of Facebook. You can't say something is meta anymore.
It's true.
I find you humans quite interesting, even though you are a worthless, greedy lot. How annoying that sound is. Fools. What fascinations there are on this planet. Strange mortals with curious customs. We'll have a storm now, and an earthquake if you like. You must stand aside, out of danger. Never mind them. People are of no value. We could make more sometime. If we need them.
They're just clay. Who cares? Itself
is only a vision. A dream. Nothing exists save empty space and you. And you.
Huh.
Yep. This was a fucking kids film. What?
Why?
What the fuck?
Seems fine to me.
Like, I love that someone in 1985 went, yeah, fuck it. Let's just make that. Let's choose an old story by Mark Twain that he just decided it's his last story that he wrote before he died. He tried to write it four times, and it's all about Satan the angel. And they were just like, you know what? In the middle of this sweet, fun, upbeat kids film, how's about we put a five-minute-long section of straight-up no-fucking-around horror? Okay, cool.
I didn't find it terribly terrifying.
I don't know.
As a kid, that would have haunted me for
weeks.
Yeah,
I mean, if I was a kid, it would be pretty scary. It's very nihilistic, but honestly, I don't think that's the most fucked up thing on the internet.
I mean, let's be fair. I was banned from displaying the plague dogs anymore, so clearly
yeah,
there is
see,
something
plague
more disturbing.
Dogs! Plague dogs is way scarier. Way
yeah, no
plague
dogs were harmed in the making of that film.
No, you're right. Okay. So there are worse things out there, but I'm
that is yeah, it's
yeah,
yeah, creepy.
I mean, look, it's creepy and it's creepy. I mean, it's cool. Spooky? I like it. Yeah, it's spooky.
Yeah, it's spooky. Okay. Okay. My apologies. I apparently haven't hit hard enough with the creep factor.
I feel like you've just come up against like Jill and I who are just like completely jaded, just like
yeah, it's like yeah, okay, whatever, Quinny.
Yeah, cool, whatever, Q.
Where's my animation button,
whatever, cool.
Well, yeah. My psyche has been shaken, if that helps.
Thank you. It does, a little bit. And I'm gonna leave you with this because this is a fucking terrible idea too.
Okay,
this is something I found on the internet at 3 o'clock in the morning once and just went, what? Oh no.
There we go.
Can you tell me a story?
I
have an idea.
So this is all about that thing of auteurs.
I wasn't sure.
People who go, oh yeah, no, I'm going to tell a story and I don't really care. Well, you know, I've got their own budget. I do what I want.
You master, me, Tutu Umong.
Susu, you mean?
Tutu Umong.
Susu, studio?
Tutu Umong.
I literally have no idea what you're saying. I'm going to call you Spot.
Spot.
Yeah.
I think it is what I've said.
So I'm not going to keep going with it because I've gone too long, but that is H.P. Lovecraft in the Frozen Kingdom, an animated film that somebody went, yeah, no, that's what we need.
That'd be up there with Nutcracker and the Four Realms in unnecessary films.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I'm like, cool. Okay, why? Why did we feel the need to do this? Because somebody thought, I've got budget, I'll do it. Nobody's going to tell me no.
I'm sure someone was like, what's an IP we can get? And someone was like, I have the life rights to Howard, to Lovecraft. And I know his niece. And then they're like, great, make a movie.
Cool, let's make three animated films. Yes,
from the producers of Food Fight. Lovecraft and the animals.
Well, this angle is giving me potion seller vibes.
Thank you. Wait till yeah comes back.
Oh. Okay, there he is. He's back.
Oh.
Hey.
Hi. That must mean it's almost time for another round of Will. Oh,
fortune.
Sorry.
Top horror. Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Now, because Amy is going next, as a result, you can put the screen back on. Because I can't judge myself.
No, it's gone.
It's gone. Oh,
no.
The audio is coming. Oh, well, that was stupid, wasn't it?
I just work here, buddy.
Yes, you do.
You are driving this bus. There you go.
Now, this round is a prize puzzle.
Oh, shit.
Prize!
Yeah. Prize! Give us prizes!
Morticia and Letitia have been working up a frightful prize for everyone tonight.
Okay, cool. What is your prize?
Let's go to the puzzle board. Oh, the puzzle relates to the prize. So if you solve the puzzle, you may get an idea of what the prize may be.
Wait, are we allowed to play? Or is the audience playing?
Oh, yes, everyone is playing now. Everyone's back.
Okay. Ooh, a fictional character.
Okay.
It is a fictional character. Here we go.
Something the something man.
Yeah, I'm on that path too.
Remember, it relates to a spooky cartoon.
There's a new
cartoon. Oh, Courage the Cowardly Dog.
Yes, it's Amy. She won.
Oh, amazing.
Well done. Well done.
How could this relate to a prize? What does it mean?
Well, Amy, you'll be pleased to know that that means you win this.
Can't wait.
Man's best friend has never been packed with so much puppy. This handcrafted artisanal sculpture has been painstakingly produced from only the finest alfoil and paper clips. The star of any occasion from home to the Louvre. Leave your friends moist and horned, no matter what side of the love A-line they're on. Valued at 1,609,575 Venezuelan bolivares. It's all yours from Compu Global Hyper MegaNet and Wheel of Fortune.
Wow.
Congratulations, you've won a dog sculpture made from alfoil and paper clips.
I don't know what to say. I've got so many people to thank. I mean, wow.
Okay.
Just even to be nominated.
Yeah, go. You've got your moment in the sun, Amy. Just like say who you want to thank. Yeah, good. The music is now playing you off.
Oops.
Everybody in the chat, yep. Thank you so much for the moral support.
Thank you to Lucretia and Morticia for making it.
Thank you, Lovecraft. Thank you, Mark.
It's
a beautiful prize. It'll be on the way soon.
Thank you. I will display it with pride.
If you want
it's a bulldog, you know, get it? Because the bulldog lives. Good one, Rob.
That's terrible.
What a great sculpture. I spent like 2 hours making that last night.
Ooh, that's you're really talented, Will.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Chess Angela is very impressed with you. It's either that or she just forgot how to write anything other than heart.
Yeah, probably that. Thank you to Lucretia and Morticia for putting on Will of Fortune with Will and Leah. And of course to our friends at CompuGlobal, HyperMegaNet, and Will of Fortune for the 1,609,575 Venezuelan Bolivares valued prize.
That's amazing here, that side. Yay! Roughly how much is that worth, Will?
That's $5 Australian.
Ah.
Amazing.
A bargain.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Anyway, on that note, it's time for that to go away. And thank you, everyone, for playing Wheel of Fortune. We'll be back next month with another game to, hurry everyone along.
Wonderful. And,
we'll find a different games show to rip off.
And games are good fun. It makes the whole thing a lot more fun.
And that means it must be Amy's turn to talk about her beautiful creative show.
Yay.
All right, let's see how this goes. I'm ready to share a screen and I need to figure out how. Here we go.
Yay. I love technology. Loves me too.
It's not doing the full screen thing. Just a second. Just a moment.
Let's just talk amongst ourselves for a moment.
It's not going to, but that's okay. You just get to see the edges of my browser.
Oh, no.
Beautiful.
Wait, Lou's coming.
Yeah, oh, no.
I love to see the edge of someone's browser. Don't say that.
All right. I can see the edges of your browser.
Your browser's showing.
There we go. That's okay. I hit all my bookmarks in case this happened.
Smart.
All right. Yeah, I learned from you.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. It was a dark and stormy. Never mind. It was a beautiful autumn afternoon. Over the Garden Wall is a surreal American folktale about two boys lost in the woods encountering a variety of strange and fantastical things along the way. If the spooky season could be distilled down to one piece of media, this would be it. The series doesn't waste any time on context or exposition. Rather, like our protagonists, we're dropped straight into the unknown. Oh. I didn't end up needing this slide, but I think it's pretty, so if we could just take a moment... I'm quite fond of it.
Yes, I love it.
Thank you. Great.
Why don't you tell us about the characters?
Yeah. Wurt is our main point of view character. He's prone to stress. Yeah, Wurt.
Wurt.
He's prone to stress and anxiety and often experiences hopelessness and low self-esteem, a stark contrast to the happy-go-lucky nature of his little brother, which is a frequent point of tension between the two. Wurt writes solemn poetry and can play the clarinet. The voice of Wurt is Elijah Wood, of course, most famous for his role as the guy in Spy Kids 3, Game Over. But you may also recognize him as Frodo in Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
He was lucky to get this role, honestly, finally made his big break.
He was like a half.
Yes, I love this guy.
Greg is Wurt's younger half-brother. He's energetic and imaginative, acting as an optimistic antithesis to Wurt. Antithesis, hard to say with fangs in. Yeah. He has strong, chaotic, good energy. He's often as perceived as having his head in the clouds, when in reality, he just confronts his problems in unusual ways.
He's cute.
Colin Dean, the voice actor, was 9 years old at the time of recording, and his other work primarily includes Doki Adventures, Loud House, and Adventure Time. Beatrice is a talking bluebird. What was that?
I like that it was like, and that's a rock fact.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you got to watch the show, man. You just got to watch it.
Okay, good.
She's a talking bluebird who promises to help the boys find their way home after they untangle her. I'm going to take my fangs out. After they untangle her from a thorned bush, she's often cynical and blunt, but practical. Though all is not as it seems with this feathered friend. Bringing Beatrice to life is the voice talent of Melanie Linsky, who's primarily known for live-action roles such as in 2 and a Half Men, Ever After, But I'm a Cheerleader, and Heavenly Creatures. Greg's pet frog is given many names throughout the story, including Kitty, Benjamin Franklin, Dr. Cucumber, Greg Jr., and more. He joins Wirt and Greg on their search for a way home and sometimes has the ability to speak English and sing. 83-year-old jazz singer Jack Jones lends his voice to the frog. He's primarily known for his work in pop and jazz from the 60s to now and has won 2 Grammy Awards. The Woodsman is an intimidating, mysterious, and sage character the boys encounter early on. He's determined to a fault with keeping the flame within his strange lantern alight. But why? What could his obsession have to do with the overarching story? And is he a friend or foe? You'll have to watch to find out.
Friend or foe?
Actor Christopher Lloyd finally got his big break working on this show, having only worked on small, lesser-known franchises like Back to the Future.
Never heard of it.
The Beast is almost always depicted in the form of a silhouette. This shadowy figure is well-spoken and manipulative and has the power to possess other creatures. He has a humanoid shape and a pair of antlers, largely inspired by the German poem Erkelmich, meaning Elf King. The Beast's presence haunts Wirt and Greg throughout their journey until they have no choice but to face him and everything he represents. Voice actor Samuel Raimi is otherwise most recognized for French and Russian cinema. Our wandering adventurers encounter a host of diverse characters along their journey, ranging from adorable to nightmare fuel.
Okay.
These minor roles are filled by an impressive voice cast, including the likes of Tim Curry, Fred Stoller, Shirley Jones, Sam Marin, Bebe Neuwirth, and John Cleese. I almost need to address the forest itself as a character rather than just a setting, because children lost in the woods are one of the most common fairy tale tropes. They're dark and deep, filled with untold dangers and a malicious evil lurking at the center. They often represent unnameable fears which must be reconciled in order to grow up. This is the case for the unknown as well. But where past forests have represented tangible fears like stranger danger, the price of disobedience, and the necessity of humility, the unknown embodies a more existential fear, uncertain and uncontrollable futures. I'm forgetting to blink so my contacts are drying out like nobody's
going
to.
No one can see you. Blink all you want.
Yeah, you can blink all you need. It's fine.
I'm trying to breathe, so it's like... Anyway, the series was created by Patrick McHale for Cartoon Network in 2014. Patrick McHale has previously worked on projects such as The Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack and Adventure Time. Sorry, I'm talking really fast because I got carried away on this presentation. There is a lot. Over the Garden Wall was based on McHale's animated short film Tome of the Unknown, originally pitched in 2006, in which Wirt and Greg encounter a society made of vegetables. Early drafts of episodes from the show's pitch bible include a skinless witch character, a villain who carves dice from the bones of kidnapped children, and a deal with Old Scratch, aka the devil. The series' environment utilizes 19th and 20th century Americana, while its digital backgrounds are designed to resemble grisaille and canvas paintings. Most of the storyboard artists worked out of the US, but the animation was sourced to South Korea, a studio called Digital Emation. The art style evokes vintage postcards, chromolithography, and magic lantern images. The story takes inspiration from innumerable sources, from Uncle Remus, Aesop's Fables, Alice in Wonderland, The Wizard of Oz, Dante's Inferno, Shirley Temple, Betty Boop, Cab Calloway, McLaughlin Brothers Games, Studio Ghibli, and so, so many more. It's a classic folktale with a twist and increasing relevance in uncertain modern times. feel free to interrupt me at any point, because we're going to be
weirded out by like how it manages to incorporate.
I like hearing about it. It's a good show.
Okay, cool. Have you seen it?
Yes, I have watched it. I love it.
Okay.
Cool. So it's a ongoing series?
No.
It's wrapped up. Yes,
very short
10 episodes.
Okay.
I'm just going to play a quick video from it, if that's all right.
Yeah.
Bringing bad luck to my tavern.
I'm Wirt, and this is Gregory.
And that's a horse.
That's great. Who are you?
I'm Wirt. I'm just a guy, I guess. What do you mean?
Well, he's the butcher.
I'm the butcher.
The baker.
Yeah!
The midwife. The master and apprentice. The tailor. And I'm the tavern keeper. Who are you?
I'm hungry.
I don't know. I don't really like labels. I'm just sort of like myself, you know?
Maybe he's simple.
No, I'm just lost. See, we're trying to get to...
I'm the highwayman.
Okay, good to know. Well, so you see...
I'm the highwayman. I make ends meet just like any man. I work with my hands. If you cross my path, I'll knock you out, drag you off the road, steal your shoes from off your feet. I'm an highwayman, when I make it.
All right.
Okay, that's
a bit of a sample of the mood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So is there a lot of music throughout?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. And I'll talk about that next.
Okay.
What is this delightful tree font?
So I found somebody had made a font that is pretty much the title font.
Oh,
and I
used
it pretty much on my slides.
Send it to me.
I can. Yeah. Yeah, it's cool. It's probably copyrighted for commercial use, but private use, all good.
Yeah.
Okay. Pieces based on pre-1950s music are heard throughout the series by a producer called The Blasting Company. Elijah Wood said that if this show were a record, it would be played on a phonograph. The DVD release of the series came with a composer's cut feature, allowing the viewer to enjoy the visuals and soundtrack without dialogue, which I thought was a really nifty idea, showing off the score. There are many instances of characters singing, including Greg's annoyingly catchy Potatoes and Molasses.
Yes! Oh my god.
So catchy.
And molasses.
Well, before I watched this show, it was on my Spotify recommended, and I was like, what is this nonsense? And then I watched the show, and I can't stop listening to it. So good.
Completely forgot about it until you mentioned it.
Yeah. A wide variety of official and unofficial merchandise is available relating to the show. From art books. Yeah, so cute.
So tiny.
Hot Topic costumes and a vinyl soundtrack and themed cassette from Mondo. I'm surprised they haven't released pop vinyls from this because the style would suit it really well.
Oh, those dolls are cute.
Casper, for Casper, it's on Blu-ray as well.
Yes.
Nice.
That's at the end of my slide.
Oh.
Uh-huh. I got all the information covered. Hold your questions till the end.
Sorry.
It's all right. The characters have become popular choices for cosplay, Halloween costumes, and fan art, as shown here. Oh, I unfortunately couldn't find the credit for the first one, but... the socials of the other ones are all on there.
Nice.
A one-shot comic book adaptation of the same name was produced by Kaboom in 2014, which was supervised by Mikhail and illustrated by Jim Campbell, a writer and storyboard artist on the TV series. The success of the standalone comic led to further issues being commissioned, detailing events that occurred in between certain episodes and expanding on the existing story. This paved the way for an ongoing comic series, which served as a sequel and prequel to the show. 38 issues were produced in total, concluding in 2019. So, you know, quite a way from when the show started. It was pretty successful. I'm going to have to look into them because I haven't actually read any of them.
That's understandable.
Yeah, because I only discovered the show like a couple weeks ago. So good. The show was critically acclaimed and met with an array of awards and nominations, including Emmys, a Teen Choice Award, and voice acting recognition. Jason Bree of Agents of Geek called the miniseries the greatest thing Cartoon Network has ever produced. And that's, you know, that's saying something.
It is.
Kevin Johnson of the AV Club also praised the series, writing that with such a perfect blend of mood, atmosphere, story, and characterization, Over the Garden Wall's 10-episode run will leave you wanting more. But like every great fairy tale, it's a story that knows when it's over. It has become a widely beloved Halloween staple and has a passionate fan base around the world. The unassuming, innocent-looking cartoon pairs intense, dark themes and whimsical and charming design, all wrapped up in an endearing little package. Halloween viewing... yeah, okay, I'm missing a bit of script.
Okay.
Something Halloween viewing and will leave you feeling a nifty balance of both comforted and creeped out. If you enjoyed Adventure Time or Gravity Falls, you're sure to have some fun with this, and it's not a huge time investment with the 10 episodes totaling around 2 hours all up.
That's an easy watch.
Yeah. Over the Garden Wall is currently available in Australia with a Stan membership, as well as on DVD and Blu-ray, and I would recommend it to anyone looking for something to snuggle while snuggled up under a blanket with a pumpkin spice latte.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yay. And that's it. It's done.
Yay.
Well done.
I'm going to rewatch it this weekend.
That was a shambles.
I haven't seen it in ages.
No, so God, have you seen any of my presentation?
Yes, Sarah, still haven't gotten beautiful. To his
yet. Amazing.
I'm very
that
excited.
Was fantastic, Amy. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Please, also, everyone, like, celebrate days. Our newest mate, Amy, and her beautiful presentation.
Yay!
Now I'm just going to never watch this back.
That- never. I've it's never watched anything back. Don't do it. Don't do it.
Yeah. Quinny deletes these ones. He doesn't want
yeah, them. No, totally. I don't put these onto YouTube or anything.
Yeah, these don't. These don't go up. Well, thank you so much. That was just beautiful. I think it's going to come back for a second.
Good. Okay.
Just quickly. Come back. So we can share the screen. Quickly on my thing. I've been like something's been happening lately, and I didn't really have time to make a whole presentation, but I did want to talk about a couple shows that are near and dear to my heart. First one, Scooby Doo Mystery Incorporated, one of the best animated shows of recent times. Basically reimagines Scooby Doo as an ongoing mystery. It came out around the same time as Young Justice and The Legend of Korra and Thundercats. It's really good, just great. It has like lots of character depth and like an interesting mystery and ongoing story. It's amazing. And Scooby Doo has been on TV basically nonstop since 1969, which is pretty fucking crazy.
Holy moly. Wow.
Like, I don't think there's been a year where it's not been shown on TV since
then. And Frank Welker has basically been in it from the get-go. Has always been Freddy and has always done Scooby.
Yeah. And then the other one I want to talk about, which is a bit of a deeper cut, is of course the beautiful anime Mushishi, which is a bit like if Studio Ghibli was a bit creepier and a bit more esoteric. It's about a wandering spirit guide who can connect with nature spirits known as Mushi. And he's a Mushishi, which is a Mushi master. And he basically travels around finding like all these people whose lives are being sort of thrown into chaos by these nature spirits, often like in slightly disturbing or creepy ways. It's really interesting and beautifully done. So please check that out. I think it's on like Funimation and Crunchyroll and those kinds of things if you want to watch it. But cool. It's like up there with the good ones.
All right,
now,
cool.
Yeah. Yeah, it's amazing. Now for why I couldn't have done a full presentation this week is because we've had some exciting news in Will Camp.
It's all coming in from Willtown.
Yeah. So I made a game show instead of a presentation. So exciting news is that myself and my partner of writing things, Laren Bright, who wrote Batman the Animated Series and Captain Planet, which you'll remember from your childhood, has just been funded by Screen Australia. And we are going into development on a new animated series, which amazing. You are getting the first public sneak peek at.
Ooh, exclusive.
This is fucking cool, man.
The show is being produced by ourselves and our partners at Tone Plus Animation, who do a lot of the animation work for Kingdom Hearts and Final Fantasy in Japan. So it's going to be a full AAA video game style anime.
Sick.
It's amazing.
And it is called Tell Us.
Ooh. Tell us all more. About it.
It is a environmental adventure anime about three outcast youth who find themselves thrown together and have to find out about the mysterious force corrupting their planet's energy.
Cool.
Yeah. So don't have anything really to show you, but there's a spot of... This is all we have to show you because it's super early. But we're working away on something for early next year to have something actual to show people. But there's a Spotify playlist you can go and listen to, which has some of the music that's inspired us while we were making it, if you feel like having something to listen to. So we'll share that.
Give you a bit of an idea of the tone of the series and the feel and everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, okay. Can you give us anything like a vague kind of, I mean, it's Captain Planet for a new generation, but not with a Captain Planet, or where are we?
Yeah.
At
so, like if Captain Planet is like an environmental cartoon show, this is Captain Planet, but like without the cheesy superhero. It's all about the young kids who are working together, and diverse kids as well, which is exciting and for a bit of an older audience than something like that. So it's more like a Legend of Korra kind of targeted show than like a kiddie cartoon.
That's very cool, man. And so you're saying like this is so I'm sure that people are probably going, yeah, okay, that's cool, we've all got an idea for a cartoon, but how did you go about getting it made? Like, what was the process for you?
It took a long time, like several years to get us to this point. Basically I got in touch with Laren just like over email. I was like, hey, do you want to like, get in touch and have a chat kind of thing? And then, we were talking about like, the shows he'd worked on, that kind of thing. And like, why hasn't there been a sort of environmental show for so long? Because like in the 90s, there was Fern Gully and, Captain Planet and all these like environmentally conscious sort of shows, which don't really exist anymore. So we wanted to do it, but sort of bring it up to date for a new generation and really just like a ton of working stuff out and then, reaching out to people. And we have a really cool writing team. Apart from me and Laren, who are the two token white dudes, everyone else on the writing team are women, and majority are women of color, which is really exciting. So
amazing.
Yeah, it's exciting. Looking forward to having more to show you sort of next year sometime, maybe.
Hell yes.
And this is like... This
so I'm not, I'm not, I promise I'm not just an idiot who makes game shows and crass jokes on here.
I'm just super impressed that like this you managed to get it in front of Screen Australia and this has now been funded. This is all full steam ahead.
Yeah, it's not like gonna be on Netflix or anything like that anytime soon, but it's sort of moving ahead to the point where maybe we can get it there, which is cool.
That's so cool.
It is super cool, and I'm really hoping that throughout the course of the actual process of the whole thing that we can kind of check in with it, see how it's going.
Yeah, yeah.
And, this can be your place where you get to tell
just the select group of people all of the cool shit about Tellus.
Yeah, it'll be cool. I'll definitely, you know, whenever stuff happens, we'll if I have like video or anything like that. But yeah, it's exciting. I think in the next like little while, we're literally working with the studio in Japan and actually making like a short snippet of the show to show people we have meetings and stuff.
This concept, like proof of concept piece, is just beautiful.
Mm. Oh yeah, it's great. I didn't draw it, obviously.
Oh, I don't know.
You can't be good at everything.
Did you commission it, or was it the final?
I commissioned it, and it's my concept, but it is not my art.
And just as a matter of interest, the title, where does that come from?
It is Latin for Earth, and the idea is that it is Earth, but not Earth, as you know, it's as we sort of say, it's a world not unlike our own. So it's Earth, but a sort of fantasy version of Earth. So there are bits of the real world that you'll recognize in it and bits that are like far out in sort of Dune style fantasy and all that kind of thing as well, but sort of mishmashed with the real world.
Nice.
Yeah. That's super cool, man. Very, very cool.
Yeah.
Well, so, congratulations.
Anyway, enjoy looking at the picture for 2 seconds and yeah.
Yay.
Yay. Yay.
I don't mean to brag for a bit, but
you do, and you should. You're allowed. And, like, congratulations.
I needed something to show. Right? So I was like, oh, I guess I'll show them that. But yeah, I'm only just now allowed to talk about it. So it's fine.
It must be exciting to be able to talk about it now.
Yeah, it's fine.
Yes.
Yeah.
Shout out to Gary in the chat there. Gary is also a lovely person who is all about that world building. Gary is one of the people who runs Gestalt comics in
Cool. Nice.
He's based in Melbourne, but also in WA and so forth. And cool. Yeah, one of those wonderful people who I'm like, yes, yes.
Yes, nice. Lovely Wolfgang at Gestalt.
Yes, you know Wolf. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, then you'd probably know Gary too. Then you will learn.
I don't, but I have met Wolfgang.
Right. Well, then you will. You will come to know Gary.
Yeah. Well, I'm happy to.
Sounds like a threat.
Yes, you will come to know Gary.
You'll know him.
Biblically. No, hang on.
Sorry, Gary.
Oh.
Yeah. Speaking of biblical things, I think I'm smelling. Is it? It's the reboot.
Oh! I almost forgot about that part.
I'm slightly horrified as to why it smells biblical.
Has the boot itself been rebooted? I can't remember what the boot looked like.
It's a different. It's
you,
a different.
Do you know
boot?
It?
It's a different boot.
Different boot. Yeah.
Like, because if that's the case, I never want to look in that boot.
Where's that? I have another boot.
Why?
I like that one's, everyone that one's the next month. Just looking
that's next month's boot.
That's
next
I love that the boot is being rebooted.
That's next month's boot. Yeah, that's next month. That's next month's boot. Yeah.
Cool, okay. Cool. Yeah, I love that you all give me shit for looking off camera and grabbing things, and yet he just pulls an entire phone. Like, I got a boot. Oh, I've got another boot. Cool. I'm happy for you. What have I got? Water bottle there. Yeah, it's not so exciting, is it?
I don't have any other boots. I'm sorry. So that must mean it's time to decide which cartoon character would survive the zombie apocalypse the best.
Ooh.
Rebooting the cartoon characters as members of the crew fighting the Walking Dead, if you will.
Okay, so it's specifically a zombie apocalypse?
It could be any apocalypse or plague, but seeing as we're currently living through a plague, I'm gonna go with zombies on this one as being more exciting than the current one.
I'm gonna say Samurai Jack.
Yes. He's
been through some stuff.
Yep, I think.
And looks good doing it.
And has a sword, which is generally well respected as being a good way of surviving zombies.
Mm. I can't say I've really seen a lot of zombie content from Japan, so I'm happy to set this one in Japan with Samurai Jack.
Okay.
Good point. We've got Train in Busan from, is that Korea?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of any Japanese zombie media. I'm sure it exists.
Frankenstein Girl and Zombie Girl, I think, but that's, I mean, whether or not that's really the traditional Japanese style or whether that's just that weird Japanese kind of sexy horror stuff.
Maybe yeah, there's like High School of the Dead and stuff, but I don't know if that's explicitly zombies.
Oh my God, High School of the Dead is terrible.
Luckily, I haven't seen it.
Oh, don't bother.
It's so bad.
There's like weird gravity defying breasts and it's, it's a weird one.
Yeah.
There's like bullet time with boobs. Like it's, I mean, maybe watch it if that's your
thing. But, yeah. Rob's asking the question, are we talking slow zombies or speedrunners from 28 Days Later?
Here's the thing, super zombie plague, it's both. Plus medium speedrunners. Like plus power walkers.
So every kind
but
of
they have, but they have to do like but they have to do Olympic walking, so they can't take both feet off the ground at once. They have to do the funny.
What
the
about
funny
the ones that just participate for charity and are dressed in costumes?
Yeah. Like zombie walk zombies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fun run zombies.
It's literally just one long line of zombies that crosses the globe, and when you come into the path of the zombie train, then you have to get out of the way.
So like train Spoopiest, but triggered from last episode.
My suggestion, and this is just because I think this is one of those ones that would probably work well, is Jason Thunder, the Wheeled Warriors. because they spend most of their time in stupid cars. Hang on, where is it? There. So there's a whole bunch of car-related action, and all the cars have, like, weapons. And so I'm kind of like, yeah, this is a smart way of doing zombies. That's my suggestion.
That's a weird one.
Yeah, I know, right? I was going for deep on weird.
Well done. Okay. You nailed it.
Jill, who's who would your suggestion be?
Oh my God. I don't know. I was joking like at the start of the show of like Rainbow Bright in The Walking Dead. Like what would that look like? She'd get around on, was it Stormy the horse or something, and just like, I don't know, maybe she's pelting them with lightning bolts or something.
Fuck yeah, let's do that.
That would be kind of sick. Yeah. And then like as she goes past, like the rainbow maybe like heals the zombies.
Uh-huh.
I like this. This is thing. Nice.
Yeah.
That's sweet.
Oh. Yeah, it's a oh gosh, happy. What's happening?
So this is somebody's suggestion of Onichambara bikini zombie players.
Of
course,
that is
the most appropriate clothing choice to fight zombies is a bikini.
Which was on the Wii?
I don't know.
Oh, emulator.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
I don't know. She's got a sword.
I feel like every week we've weirdly talked about Onichambara whenever anime has been mentioned, just because Freda Kang is in the cast.
I didn't know what I was getting.
Yeah. So here is my suggestion.
Yes. Oh. Snagglepuss.
Oh my God, Snagglepuss.
We can't hear him very well, but
exit. Stage left.
But hark, or is it hurt? The cage door is open. A jar even. What a chintzy outfit. Can't even afford.
You know who Snagglepuss sounds like?
Me?
Fucking Moira Rose.
I was thinking his delivery is as good as my presentation.
Open, David.
And now, David, I exit stage left. All right, even. Where is the bebe?
Tell me, there's
Yes. Okay. So thus far, our zombie survival team.
I will say the reason why I think Snagglepuss would be good is because he would exit stage left straight to his home and stay in lockdown and get vaccinated like a good boy.
Oh, good.
So he wouldn't actually contribute to doing anything in the apocalypse.
No, but you know, like who's going to survive the zombie apocalypse? As we've learned, it's a pussy who will stay home and get vaccinated.
Wow.
You know what?
I mean that in a positive way.
I was going to say, everybody, just stay home, get vaccinated. We don't think you're pussy at all.
Be a pussy, stay home.
Yeah, I think there's a healthy level of afraid you should be in a zombie or other apocalypse, and that's when you exit stage left and sit at home till it goes away.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm trying to remember, there was a cartoon that I remember as a kid where somebody actually turns into a car. So there was Jason the Wheeled Warriors where they get into cars. There's another one where like the lead character actually just transforms into a car. It is one of the strangest.
A robot turns into a car? A human character turns into a car?
Yeah, like he's not a robot?
No. Oh. hang on, I'm now Googling. What?
I'll take this.
I'm not sure how to help you with this.
I'll take this opportunity to offer a disclaimer that if Quinny has been watching Japanese films of disrepute, that we do not endorse viewing of said content, but we do not kink shame either.
Well,
no way Quinny would watch anything to do with anime.
Yeah, no.
Well, he watched the live action version and then told him about the anime.
I feel like I've really done myself a mischief here.
Okay. Live action tentacles just aren't the same.
No, they're really not. It's never going to be quite the same. So the series was called Turbo Teen.
Okay. I marched into a government laboratory where a top secret experiment was underway. Molecular transfer ray, causing me and my car to become one. Oh no! No, 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 no. No, no, no. Don't awaken anything in me. Uh-oh.
He goes through a car wash.
There are people riding in him.
So many questions.
Okay.
What does the exhaust pipe do?
Relevant to this.
What did that exhaust pipe do?
I was watching, I was watching Maya and the Free last night, and there's this character in there called Pichu, as in like Machu Picchu, and he turns to the girl that he kind of has a crush on and goes like, would you like to ride me? And then the other character turns around and goes like, say what now? I was like, you really want to be making that joke, kids show? And then the guy goes like, oh, I meant like, you know, like on my shoulders. I was like, yeah, that's what everyone would have thought.
You didn't need to clarify it.
Yeah,
but maybe you could have worded it better.
I will always remember that in Animaniacs, which is the old fingerprints joke.
Oh yeah,
fingerprints, and then Prince is just like,
I don't think so.
So, yes, Turbo Teen. And Rob, are you trying to tell me that Turbo Teen was actually voiced by Alan Tudyk? Holy shit.
Surely
that doesn't seem right. It doesn't seem the right age for it, but you know, whatever. Something
else. Tudyk.
Well, who knows?
Twin exhaust.
This is my other suggestion, because I feel like we need a scientist on the team.
Okay.
Oh, yes, Dexter's Laboratory.
Nice.
Omelette de fromage.
Is this like one frame per hell of a long?
Yeah, one frame per 5 seconds.
Yeah.
That was some great footage of a girl
of just Dee Dee
Dexter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh well.
I have never seen any Dexter's Laboratory, so should I watch it?
Omelette du fromage.
What?
It's a Dexter's Laboratory reference.
and now Amyable needs a bit of time away because there was a little too much French there.
Yeah. Created by Genndy Tartakovsky, who did Samurai Jack.
Nice. I believe.
That yes. Classic Cartoon Network era.
Mm. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Same, yeah. Like Samurai Jack and same time as Invader Zim. Almost same sort of years and everything, which is, you know, Vasquez. I would actually love to see Invader Zim involved in our zombie survival guide.
Yeah. I thought the guy who voiced Invader Zim was very good in the new Ratchet and Clank game.
He's good.
He played Zircon Jr. just doing his Invader Zim voice, but describing various weapons in like an over-the-top way.
He's a very strange dude. Loves his musicals though. I remember hearing being at a Middle Eastern cafe with him and a bunch of other voice actors, and him doing Les Miserables, but as Invader Zim. It was.
Oh, wow.
It was a thing. Amazing. A big thing. Cool. Okay.
Shall we wrap it up, or shall we invite some people to discuss their...
I mean, I've asked in the chat whether anyone feels that they want to add anything to our zombie survival cartoon. But as yet, there's been a few suggestions in there. We've got Rick and Morty, Hiccup and Toothless, which I think would be nice. Dragons would certainly be a good start for the zombie survival.
You know, kill it with fire.
I think the cast of Are Real Monsters.
Oh, I love that cartoon.
That was definitely one of the ones I was thinking about for this episode, actually.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the monster thing, they did goofy and creepy at the same time so well.
Speaking of such things, I was going to do Trapdoor, and then I thought, okay, if I'm going to do it, I can't rely on nostalgia. I've got to rewatch it. And I got into it, and it's not scary at all. It has all the uplifting, you know, spunk of Postman Pat. But to me as a kid, it was traumatic, like the booming voice of the thing upstairs. I thought it was so scary. I thought little guy was in danger.
And the funny little skull that talked. And...
My favorite thing about that spider, the spider's name is Drut, D-R-U-T, which is turd backwards.
Nice.
And yes, Pretty Kanga makes a point. Postman Pat.
Okay, Spunky doesn't mean the same thing everywhere.
Mm. He does. I will say he is when I'm done with him.
Well, no!
There's that boot again.
The biblical cream boot. Pies.
I got the leather one for that one.
Good. I'm so glad.
Wait.
Yes, Spunky can also mean like peppy and can do.
Something's got
not
moxie.
Necessarily cute.
Yeah.
But
spunk.
Okay. Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
I've made an error.
It's like we've moved past the 90s slang. Oh, he's a spunk. No.
Yeah.
Not like that.
No, we don't want to patch your postman. Look, I think we can wrap it up there. So what we do have to discuss, because next month is we don't have a theme as such because it's not Halloween. It's November. So I don't think we're going to do fucking Thanksgiving.
Oh, I know what we can do. It's because it's Movember. Cartoon characters with mustaches.
Okay.
Honestly, it's better than the no ideas we have so far.
I was going to suggest that if we can return to one of our other suggestions that we didn't do, because we had a lot of feedback as to whether or not people wanted robots or anthropomorphic.
Teams and robots.
Oh yeah, teams. That's right. Yeah.
So,
so Casper, we could talk about the flame of teams being the flame.
Can we have your votes in the chat now? Whether you want robots or whether you want teams. And Gary said that he's gone for Miss.
Oh. Oh, that's all right, Quinny. We can read the screen.
Yeah, good. Yeah. Gary's gone for moustache, but yeah. Do we think?
Wheel of Time is starting. Do cartoons based on books?
That's a lot. Ooh. Sorry, WOT. What is WOT?
Wheel of Time.
Oh, right. And, cartoons that were cancelled too early.
SpongeBob SquarePants, The Simpsons. Oh, weren't cancelled too early. weren't cancelled early enough. Right, gotcha.
Yeah. Yes, Rob, the new Masters of the Universe, the second half of the series is coming next month. Finally, yes.
Yes, I mean, that whole 3 month wait was horrifying. Well,
why didn't it just drop all at once?
They haven't finished it.
yes, more than likely. But also that whole bullshit with the amount of people who hated it. The first five episodes who are like, oh, it's bad. And like,
there's women in my cartoon about
my cartoon is woke and I don't like it.
a small disclaimer that TELUS is super woke. Like, you'll just hate it if you hate woke. Don't worry about it.
How dare you?
But as long as it didn't start out not woke and then became woke, that's where it comes a problem.
No, it was just like knowingly woke the whole time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, that's it. It's like the phrase is get woke, go broke. If you start woke, cool, whatever.
Yeah, then it's fine.
Start woke, stay broke. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, nobody decided, so let's just do robots.
Yeah, I was gonna say. So far, Casper's the only one who's done a vote on it. So robots, it is.
Casper keeps lights on around here, so robots, it is.
If not, we can always do a rhyming show about Ram Man and Ram Man and Pebbles and Bam Bam.
Okay, that will be your video presentation for next month.
It's all going to be rhyming the whole time.
Just do some slam poetry next month.
Yeah. I'm into it. Do it. Yes, it's all the way.
Quinny, will you do like the splashy drums for me? While I'm talking the whole time.
Oh, was it So I Married an Ex-Murderer? Have you ever seen that movie?
So I Married an Ex-Murderer. I used to murder, but now I'm just getting married.
I enjoyed it because it had a whole bunch of slam poetry. Right. It says, woman, whoa, man, she broke my heart, tore it apart.
Sounds awesome.
Yeah. Yes, it has, what's his name, doing bad Scottish accents again.
Good old what's his name?
You know, that guy. Anyway, we did a little bit there.
On that note, it's been delightful having you. I've been Will and I hope you enjoyed Wheel of Fortune. We'll be back next month with another game show. Probably.
That was fun.
Let us know in the comments which game show you would like me to rip off in some horrific way. Jeopardy, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Family Feud.
Yeah.
We need some more people if we're going to play Family Feud.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. You could do like Pointless, which is just reverse Family Feud.
Amazing! Predaganger, yes! That was my favorite thing when I was in high school, that goddamn kids' game show. So cool.
Amazing!
Amazing might be difficult to pull off on Zoom, I'll be honest.
I mean, are we going to build an entire set that involves us running around with slime?
I'll do it, but, like, you know.
Please. Where to find the keys? Where are the keys? Find the keys. Oh, there's the letter! You missed the letter!
It's always behind the tree, and never look behind the tree, you little dickhead.
Find the boots.
the reboot.
But they're boots.
The reboot. Yeah.
It's like you've never watched this fucking show.
Yeah.
I mean, before you go on to the show, watch the show so you can see where to hide the keys, you morons.
Yeah. We could do like the Nintendo 64 portion of the of Amazing, oh, yeah, where they played Mario Kart against each other. Or something. But that's...
I'm still studying for Millionaire Hot Seat. So.
Look. Who wants to be a billionaire is very possible.
Yes! Oh my God. It!
Yeah.
Well, the best part about it is Amy is already a billionaire because she has won the $1 million prize.
Oh, yes. That cute little bulldog clip.
Yeah.
Hope it survives shipping.
Yeah, I don't know. If you don't, I understand if you don't want it.
Maybe we should share it and take it in turns, quarters of the year.
Yeah. Well, I'll have to make another sculpture every month. So, or something every month as a prize. So.
I'm not sure you're going to have time with all this work that you do. How are you going to find time?
I don't
to
work
build
very
something?
Much. That's fine. And I only take like 5 minutes to build something. So it takes.
Go with it. Go with it. Make it seem like it's really important.
Yes, okay. And
yes, I have been Quinny. I don't know who
been the Quinvisible Man. Yeah, she's been the Sailor Scout of your nightmares, and Amy has been
Tara
the monstress of martial arts. What? And I've been Will and yeah. And we will see you next month for more Animates, at which point I think Amy will probably be a permanent member of the Mates squad if she wants to be around. I think so.
If you like being
thank
a part
you.
Of it.
Yeah, we love Amy. You've passed the audition, the secret audition that we all planned to make.
Excellent. The one where if you'd
we can't tell you
if you'd fucked it up, we would have just,
let you come back anyway.
The door would just open and
and it would have led straight to the same place next month because we're short-staffed and no one cares.
It's just like drop you straight back in the same chair.
Yeah.
This really gave me something to hyper-focus on. Very good.
Awesome.
Have a spooky weekend, everybody.
Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Yeah. And we'll see you on Tuesday night for Squid Game.
Yeah. So.
Did the moon's full glow? I was out at the club with the music thumping. Oh, a thunder, a gray Malkin Lane as the bass bumped off the side of Snake Mountain. Jim on the stage with the hologram girls. Next up, Allison Blair to light the start of a night at the bar at the end of the world. That my jet with the growling pal, roll up.